I'm Rodney Allen Rippy. My FBI, my faith-building incident, is losing mama. Wow. Many years ago, started out my career as a child actor. Way back in the 70s, I had a wonderful opportunity to do a very famous commercial for Jack in the Box.
Hi. Haven't I seen you on TV before?
Yeah.
What's your name?
Rodney.
Rodney what?
Rodney Allen Rippy.
What's that in front of you?
A Jumbo Jack.
A Jumbo Jack?
From Jack in the Box.
Did you ever get a bite out of it?
And too big to eat.
You think you'll be able to get a bite now? Give it a try, Rodney. Tell us how you like it.
I can't. I got
Oh, okay.
Hi, I'm Rodney Allen Rippy. There's a lot of things you can eat at Jack in the Box. This is a Jack's steak sandwich, and these are pretty delicious too. And this is a taco. This is an onion ring. There might be 10,000 things at Jack in the Box. Pack up the kids, crank up the car to Jack in the Box. Come as you like, come as you are to Jack in the Box.
I was born in Long Beach, California. California native. I have a sister named Beverly Lee. My brother, his name's Kenneth Wayne. Now I'm the only one here in Southern California because my folks, they retired and moved back to the East Coast. So they're growing up on the west side of Long Beach. And it was never really something like, oh, I'm going to be this little kid actor. It was something that my mom thought it would be really funny and just something fun to try. And turned out, you know, she signed me, my brother, and my sister up with an agent. And believe it or not, my sister was the first one in the family to win a commercial, or actually land a commercial. Had the pleasure of working on some really great shows like The Odd Couple.
It would take the wisdom of Solomon to solve this.
I went to every conglomerate, every big holding company, and I finally tracked down the owner of this building. And it's a big TV star. Oh. I better pay the chance. Meet Rodney Allen Rippy!
Yeah. I am Mr. Rippy's attorney. Which one of you is Lovelace?
I am.
Yes, well, Mr. Rippy has something to say to you.
You're fired.
You'll get your severance pay in the mail. Please be off the premises by noon tomorrow.
Kitchen, free cookies and milk on me! Hey!
How does a small child like this come to own a big building?
Pet shelter.
I think we've finished our business here.
Maybe we should turn this place into a condominium.
6 million dollar man. Police story. Dr. Welby, MD. Oh, I did Laugh In. Great show. Had the pleasure of working with many greats like George Burns in Oh God Book 2. I was in Blazing Saddles, which was a crazy ride with Mel Brooks, of course. And just had a great time. Toured all around the United States. I actually was, at the age of 5, I released a kids album called Take Life a Little Easier. And so it was me singing on this album. There were like 12 songs that were pretty amazing. And this one of the main songs somehow got onto the Billboard charts. And so I'm the youngest person in history right now to land a record on the charts.
Don't get upset when things get you down. Life is too short for a world of round. Head for the hills.
I did sound like Alvin and the Chipmunks. I had this really high, squirrely little voice. It was pretty strange, but great music for kids, actually. Ended up getting my degree in marketing and advertising. Started my own marketing PR company. Working with colleagues out here in entertainment, and music, and broadcast. So launched a beautiful music radio station called KJBM Radio. So we play all beautiful music around the world, the best orchestras, all instrumental. And now I'm making my move, working on an autobiography, working on a cookbook. Got a couple of TV shows in development. Still having fun. You know, when you're in the entertainment industry, a lot of times people go, well, what do you do? Or are you just an actor? But you kind of start to learn a little bit of everything. So I got to the point where I was shooting, editing. I enjoy that. And I'm actually looking forward to making my directorial debut on a couple of projects, my own personal projects, and maybe work with some people. I got a bunch of friends out here in the industry, just different people. So we got a couple of reality shows, but I have something that's very positive that I'm putting together. Between the reality shows, and feature film things, and I may end up going back into music. So I've had an opportunity come my way where I may end up maybe making a single. I don't know, just a bit. I'm 54 years old, I'm single, no kids, never married. Hey, I don't know what happened. Been close, no cigar, no marriages or anything like that, but I honestly think that, it's funny, I thought that, by now I'm married and settled down, but you know what, God has his own time. So I'd rather be on God's time than my time. So I'm like, hey, I just keep rolling through life, taking care of business, and when it happens, it happens. You know, between doing video work, I've been on red carpets and interviewing people, and I've shot a commercial and different things like that. It's all about production. And one of the fun things is now, every Monday, well, that's our schedule on Monday mornings on the This Way Network, me and some of my colleagues, we get together, and it's a wonderful, you know, friend and broadcaster named Nina, and we do just these little talks. And we just basically talk about and kick off the week with some good news, and we just talk about certain subjects. And so I'd like for you to make sure you check us out. We're on YouTube, and it's This Way Network. As for hobbies, I love to cook. That's one thing. But I'm into classic cars. And so all my life, my dad was always out in the garage and wrenching, and I got so many funny stories because my dad, you know, I grew up in Long Beach, as I mentioned earlier, and every so often a car would come into the driveway, and my dad or his buddies, you see these guys pushing the car down the driveway, and my mom would slide the door open, stick her head out, Fred, what is this? And you see these guys pushing the car, and dad said, what does it look like? It looks like a car to me. And she's like, you dragging something in here. I said, Lassie, please go back in the house. I don't think you would do in the house. Please, let me have my fun. It was funny. And all the guys wouldn't say anything. All you see these guys are like, and they're all pushing the car. And I was just like, I'm this little kid, and I got my head popped around Mama watching this whole crazy thing. And Mama would just shake her head and shut the door. And sure enough, Dad would start, you know, restoring the car. And from being a little kid, I want to help you. He's like, man, you can't help me. So I'm like, yes, I can. No, you can't. I'm like, well, I can give you. And so finally what happened was he takes his wrenches. He had them all rolled up and tied. So he rolls out his wrenches. He goes, look, if you can memorize these wrenches and I can call them, so keep me from crawling in and out from under the car, you can be my tool man. So I was like, okay. So now I'm this little kid, and I'm studying these wrenches, and he was like, okay, give me a 9/16. I go, and he's like, hey, okay. And give me a 10 millimeter. And I'm like, 10 millimeters, aha, that's metric. And I'm like, oh. So soon I learned all these little tools, and so I was my dad's tool man. So anyway, needless to say, I caught the automotive bug, and so I've restored two 1968 Mustangs, two 1968 Camaros, and now I have a 1971 Stingray Corvette. So I have a classic Corvette, and probably looking forward to doing some more building and restoring. I'm pretty good in woodworking. So I started fooling around building stuff. I mean, if I needed something, and so I've actually had to build and construct things. And so I started thinking about it. I'm just like, that's why I think I got that from my dad. He had all the tools that he could possibly need. And I just thought that was the neatest thing. I think that in life, you need tools. You need life tools. You need, you know, spiritual tools. You need physical tools, because when things get broke, some of the stuff you can fix. The spiritual stuff, you got to take that to the Lord. But I know for a fact, you know, I'm always that guy that I'm like, well, if I can fix it, I'm going to try. That's an incredible question. How did I become a Christian? Well, I actually grew up in a household that was a typical household. Did we go to church every single Sunday? No. But there was always a real sincere awareness of God. I mean, and something much bigger than me and us. And I always remember, you know, Mom always, growing up, she was always the one to say, you know, quit acting up. You know, Lord's looking at you. And I was like, oh. And that was a good feeling, because I really took that into my adult life. And you really, if you're walking through life and you always say to yourself, you know, God's watching me. God knows everything. And so it kind of makes you think like, you know what? I need to be aware. I need to be aware of what I'm saying, how I'm acting, where my thoughts are, where am I wasting my time or investing my time. I believe that probably when I became a Christian was when I moved back to Southern California. And I was born in Long Beach. And then in 1980, my parents decided to move to North Carolina. When I moved back to Southern California, when I was like 19 years old. Because you have to repent and you have to give your life to the Lord, you know, and receive that. You know, there's nothing that we could do to get to heaven. It's all through God's grace and His redemptive power. There's nothing that we could do to earn this type of, you know, blessing of salvation. That has to be, you know, granted. You know, the Lord granted us that for what He's done. So I made a conscious decision that I said, you know, I know that I can't do this myself. I know that there's no way that I could save myself. And I knew I was a sinner. I knew that. And so I said, well, and I wanted to make sure that I had my life secure with the Lord. And I said, I made a conscious decision. I gave my life to the Lord. I accepted what He did on the cross. And there are so many things much bigger than what I would know. And it's a thing that I knew I'm going to grow in this. I'm going to grow in knowledge. I'm going to grow in a deeper personal relationship with the Lord. And that's what I want. I gave my life to the Lord, and I knew there was only one way to do it, and to accept what He's done for me and what He's done for me. My FBI, my faith building incident, probably was definitely losing my mom. And I was a senior in high school, and few years prior to that, Mom had started having a battle with cancer and things like that. And I just remember Mom being in the hospital. And it was just a day I went to go visit her. And it was just me and her. We were just sitting there in the hospital together. And I was just thinking about so many things. And my mom asked me, she said, Rodney, what are you going to do? And I said, well, Mom, in a few months, I'm going to be graduating high school. And my mom said, well, I thought you said you wanted to go to college. I said, out in California. I said, I do. I said, but I got to make sure you're going to be all right. And my mom looked at me and she said, you know what, Rodney? No matter what happens to me, you're going to be all right. And I took that to heart. I heard exactly what she said. And she said, if you want to go back to California and go to college, she said, go out to California, go to college. She said, but promise me one thing. You'll go out there and you'll be a good boy and you won't get yourself in any trouble. And Mom, laying there in the hospital bed, says that to me. And that was another faith-building incident, and that was another reason why I knew that I needed to be able to have some form of salvation. I needed to have that something that's going to ground and root me, because life, opportunities, chances, bad decisions, I had feelings that this was, that was just a part of life, growing and growing through life's experiences. So, and I know that that was the time that I, in that talk that my mom had given me. A couple of weeks went by and she started progressively getting worse and worse and worse. And I remember I was actually at school one day and this girl comes running in, looks around and slaps a note on the desk and it said, "Get to the hospital now." And I look at this thing, I was like, "Where did this come from?" And the girl goes, "Go." And I was like, oh, so I jump up and I grab my books and throw them in my book bag and I tear out the room. I drive like a maniac. I come running in the hallway and I slide in the room and look, and everybody's there and they're like, "Hey, you know, your mom's breathing got a little choppy there." So, and I was like, "Man," I was like, "How is she?" And so they're like, "Well, she's okay. She's stabilized." And I was like, wow. About a week later, I'm at school again, sitting there. This girl bursts in the classroom, slaps a note down. I see this thing and says, "Get to the," I'm like, "Man," grab my books, same episode, jump in the car, rip through town, run in. And this time it's pretty serious and we're all standing there. So I'm there and I'm like, "Man, what's going on?" I remember everybody being in the room. I mean, cousins, my auntie, my dad, everybody, we're all standing here. So I squeezed through this maze of people and I'm at the foot of the bed of my mom and I'm watching the monitor and the heart monitor and I'm standing there and my mom, she's real heavily sedated, but she opened her eyes and she looked around the room at everybody real slow. She looked around at everybody standing around the foot of the bed. And I stepped to the foot of the bed and I shook my mom's foot. I said, "Hey, Mama." I said, "I'm here." I said, "How you doing?" I said, "Give me a smile." She looked at me and looked right at me and smiled. And then she looked back around the room a couple more times and she closed her eyes and she passed away. I literally felt like something left the room. So everyone, of course, burst into tears. People started crying. And I stood there and I said, "Okay, Rodney, Mama is gone." And I said, "You are officially a man. All the advice she gave." So while I literally drowned out, literally my hearing just like cut off. And I'm having this conversation in my head. I don't hear anybody crying and screaming. Anything. I said, "Every piece of information she ever gave you, you better lock it in." I said, "Because there's no more information that's going to come from Mama." I said, "So everything that she said, all the values, the principles, literally till this day, skills." I remember being a little kid and I said, "Mama, you know, can you sew my button off?" My button came off my shirt. And she's like, "Let me help you out." She goes and gets a needle and thread. And she goes, "Let me show you, boy, how to do this." She said, "Now you put the needle and thread in through the back and through the buttonholes." And I was like, "No, go ahead there." "No," she goes, no, "I'm gonna make you do it." So she's sitting here coaching me and I'm like, "Sewing, keep going, a couple more loops and through the back, tie it off, cut it, there you go." She goes, "Now you'll never have a wobbly button again." And I'm like, "Yeah, all right, I'm like, pretty good at that." And so between those type of things, my brain is going through all of this while that at that moment, I just said, "Well," I said, "You know, Rodney," I said, "Mama's gone." And I said, and I just realized, I said, "What she has given you in these 18 years, that's it. That is it. So all of that stuff, all that value, you must hold on to." And that's what I did. That's what has kept me. And that really was my faith building moment, because when she passed away, I had two ways I could go. I could have got angry at the Lord. "Why'd you do this? Why now? Why'd you ever take her? Why didn't you heal her?" I could have came through all kind of crazy stuff. But I'd had to accept it. And I said, "You know what, Rodney? the Lord knows far more better than you. I know it don't feel right. It don't feel good, but you have to accept this. And so my faith building moment was seeing her pass away. And then I knew that there's something much bigger. There's something beyond this. And I also accepted the fact that, you know, I look forward to being able to see her again, you know? So I said, you know, I kind of was able to pull it all together. And I think that built my faith a lot. That was seriously my faith building moment, to not let it, you know, crush me, but to learn and to accept and know that God knows best. If you're personally going through this, if you've got a loved one, someone that you may be losing, someone that's going through a battle, you have to understand that we all will at some day pass away. And someday you have to just say to yourself, you know, all you can do is pray and ask, and you have to understand that God's purpose is his direction. His plan is much bigger than ours, and he has a perfect plan. Sometimes it doesn't seem perfect, but it is perfect. It's 100% perfect and correct all the time. It's not some of the time, it's all the time. The thing that I did that helped pull me out of a very, you know, heartbroken moment was to know that, okay, mama's not here, but just imagine what she might be seeing right now. Imagine the beauty, the glory, the splendor, and what it would be like to be brand new and to be able to make it into the kingdom. The one thing is to accept it, you know, because there's nothing that we could do that, you know, and it's not our timing. And of course, we want to love and hold on to things. I mean, I've had friends who've lost pets and grieved heavily, but I told them, I said, listen, do understand that everything is finite and it's gonna happen. But think of good thoughts. Think of the good times. Remember the good times. And that's why through life, I try to make sure that I have as many good memories, take as many pictures. So a lot of times families have little silly incidences that don't get fixed and it becomes a problem years and years and years later. Let it go. Forgive. Communicate. Understand that, yeah, maybe somebody's having a bad day and that's why things happen or things were said. Never let that get in the way of making sure that things are repaired. Really, when a person passes away, you're not going to have that opportunity to say, I'm sorry, I love you. So give those roses now. You know, forgive now. Keep that communication going. There's something beyond this life. And so, and you think about it, and I think about it too, and I'm like, okay, that's why you got to keep sending up timber, as they say. Keep sending up timber and doing your best. And of course, having that real relationship, you know, with the Lord and letting build it within you what you need. And of course, we're not always going to be perfect. We're going to fail. We're going to fall down. But you got to get back up, get yourself together, and keep moving forward. When I was going through that time with my mom, the thing that really helped me get through it was thinking about the good times, thinking about those good memories and all of those things. And, of course, holding on to the important things that she showed me. I mean, watching her cook in the kitchen and recipes and things like that. And those value-added things that she gave me about life. And I remember that she was always referring to, you know, my dad, you know, because she had that love and respect for my father. And so, and it was mutual. And I think all of those things that parents show kids, and if you don't have and a lot of times some people don't have the best of parents out there, sadly. But think about that one thing or that one person that did pour into your life that good information, those things that helped you along, those things that built you up, made you a better person, or taught you some type of life skill. Those are the type of things you hold on to. Those, and if you're hurting going through a tough time, you have to find a way to keep yourself together. You have to find those things that give you joy. Find a friend. Find a support group. You're not the only person who's went through this. I thought, like, you know, when it happened to me, that I felt like I was the only person in the world. And I really realized, I said, Rodney, many people have lost loved ones, parents, you know, wives, sons, you know, children. You have to be able to say, okay, I don't understand this. It doesn't feel, you know, this is not a good feeling. But you have to say, okay, how can I pull myself through these times? How can I pull myself through these times? And it's all about getting engaged. That same situation is going to happen when you may pass away. Who's going to be heartbroken? How would you want them to handle it? We all will go through this. We are born. We will pass away. And the best thing to do is between being born and passing away, that middle time is what really counts. That's when you love on people and you have them and you give and you exchange and you remember and you forget. You can't let losing a loved one crush you. You have to say, and live on in their honor. That's what I do. Whenever I've been around relatives and friends, and I say, man, I'm going to miss this guy. I'm going to miss this person. But I'm going to live on and celebrate them. I'm going to celebrate them through my life, and I'm going to just keep going. You know, that's what you have to do. Keep going. You can't let it stop you. You must enjoy this gift of life that we're given. After my mom had passed away, a few months had went by, and my dad sat me and my brother and my sister down, and he said, I got something to tell you. And we're like, okay, what's up? And he said, I feel like I'm going to die. And we were like, I about passed out. Dad, I said, can you say that again? And my dad said, I feel like I'm going to die. He goes, you know, you lost a mom. He goes, I lost a friend. I lost everything. And then I start really thinking about this. I was like, wow, he did lose a lot. And I know how much my mom literally helped my dad. I mean, she was like, really, like his rock. He said, you know, some people at the church want me to get out, and they're trying to help me, and they want me to, you know, start seeing people. And I was like, Daddy, look, you can do whatever you want. If it's going to make you feel better, I'm like, by all means, go. Hey, we're not going to stand in the way. If you feel that you need to have a helpmate, please do. Under 10 months of my mom dying, my dad was remarried, and my stepmom was in the house. The point is, I heard what Dad said, and I knew how much that void. And so what I would say to anyone, as much as you love a loved one, if it is for a husband and wife situation, if you lose a loved one, you'll never replace that person. You'll never, ever replace that person. You're not trying to. But you must live on, because there's something in you that when you lose a loved one, you really, something in you passes away. You have to keep going, because if you don't, it will drain you and drain you and drain you. So my best advice, and I'm not Dr. Rodney, but I would tell you, I know it works. And I would advise anybody to find another love. Find someone that you could spend, a friend, someone that you could talk to. The Lord is your shepherd. I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. Remember these incredible words from the scripture. Study these things and really, really understand that the Lord is trying to speak to you. He's really, really trying to speak to you through the scriptures in time of need, time of question, time of sorrow, time of victory. It's all there. How do I share my faith? I try to share my faith through my daily walk. I try to share my faith by walking it and not just talking it. You really have to be forgiving. You have to be, and I try. Lord knows, I have my moments like everybody else, but you have to always kind of course correct. We have to listen. And when people are talking, it's not a debate. It's not a challenge. It's not, oh, I'm right and you're wrong. It's not that. It's just, can I offer you something? Can I offer you something similar to what you're going through personally and how it worked for me? You can share these type of things, and a lot of times it really truly is about being accountable. You know, it's hard to talk to someone else if they look at your life and your life is kind of squirrely. You know, you have to really make sure that when you're talking to people, you're not talking down to anyone. We're all in this together. We all have fallen and, you know, come short of the glory of God, but he's always there loving with outstretched arms, wanting to receive us and take us in. And matter of fact, he made the first move to love us first. So I'm like, you know, he did his move. He came towards me. And so, you know, come on. It's a thing that every day is a new day. It's an opportunity to say, okay. And with every day when the sun rises up, I think to myself, today is going to be a good day. So we should start out that with that type of thankfulness. And you have to be honest. There's people who went to bed last night and they did not have that next morning. So I am always thankful. And by the end of the day, you want to wake up with thankfulness before you go to bed, have some thankfulness and say, Lord, if it's your will that there's a tomorrow, you know, I look forward to it. If not, cleanse me, take and bring me on home. Just that simple.
Ben Gillette said something that was very convicting. He said, how much do you have to hate somebody to believe everlasting life is possible and not tell them that?
Wow, that's pretty serious.
So as Christians, many times we'll love people to hell because we're not telling them the way to heaven.
That's right.
You know, 150,000 people die every day. You've gone through that with your mom. You've talked a lot about, you know, there is an ending for all of us. Mm-hmm. So, Rodney, if you died tonight, are you 100% sure you'd go to heaven?
Yes. I am 100% sure that I would go to heaven because I cannot be snatched out of the hand of God because I have given my life to him. And that's it's a one-way deal. When you do that, too late. Hey, you're locked up forever. It's a good deal.
I want to walk you through the good person test. Okay. And this comes right out of the Bible when the rich young ruler runs to Jesus and says, good master, what must I do to be saved? And he said, why do you call me good? There's none good but God.
That's right.
So how many lies have you told in your life?
Probably too many, yes.
So what do you call someone who's told so many lies they can't remember?
Human?
What does the world call someone who tells lies?
A liar.
So what are you?
I'm a liar.
Okay. Have you ever stolen anything, no matter how small the value?
Yes.
Okay. What do you call someone who steals?
A thief.
Okay. So what are you?
I'm a thief.
Okay. Have you ever taken the Lord's name in vain?
Yes.
Okay. And that's called blasphemy. It was so serious in the Old Testament, it was punishable by death.
I know.
Do you love your mom?
I do.
Would you ever use her name in vain?
No.
And why not?
Because I love her.
And you respect her. And yet we use the name of God who gave us mothers and who gave us life.
That's right.
So have you ever looked with lust?
Yes.
Okay. And Jesus says in the Bible that if you look with lust, you've already committed adultery in your heart.
That's true.
So I am not judging you at all. But by your own admission, you're a liar, a thief, a blasphemer, and adulterate heart.
That's pretty rough.
Yeah. So, Rodney, on Judgment Day, when you're standing before a holy God, his standard is perfection. Are you innocent or guilty?
Guilty.
Heaven or hell?
Hell.
So what did God do so that us sinners don't have to be in his prison called hell, but we can be with him in heaven?
He died on the cross. He gave us that opportunity to accept his redemptive power. And he took all of my sins and all the other sins of the world upon him. And he made it possible for us to be able to go to heaven.
And so many people know that Jesus died on a cross, but they don't make the connection that we sinned. We deserve hell. He paid our fine. So right before he dismissed his spirit, right before he died, because it was his choice to die, he said, it is finished. That means he did it all. We can't work our way to heaven. We can't bribe God in any way. The Bible says that. We deserve that hell and punishment. But think of a court of law. If you go in and you've admitted you're guilty and the judge says, throw the book at him. And Jesus walks in and says, no, I paid his fine. He's mine. That's how you can be with him in eternity. So all we have to do is repent and trust in Jesus. And think about being at 10,000 feet in an airplane and you have to jump, right? A lot of people are going to say, hey, I'm good. I'm a good person. I'm going to flap my arms. I don't believe in gravity. I got this. And as Christians, we need to say, you're going to die. Don't do that. Just put on a parachute and you'll be okay. And the Bible says, put on the Lord Jesus Christ. And when we do that and we have that jump into eternity, which is death, then we have safety and assurance with God in heaven. So it's repenting and trusting in Jesus.
Beautiful. And always know that, you know, the Lord loves you. And really take that time to have a personal relationship. It's not about your family, it's not about your girlfriend, it's not about anything. It's really about your one-on-one personal relationship with the Lord. And if you say, you know what, I don't feel it. I don't know. I just don't understand. And how can it be? If you open your life up, if you open communication up with the Lord and say, Lord, I want to know you better. Show me yourself. Help me to understand. The Lord will reveal to you, and you will by and by. And if you are sincere and you are pressing forth to that communication and that relationship, just open your ears up. You'll start having people saying things to you, and things will start coming to you that you've never experienced before. And you'll say, that's not coincidence. Because if it all of a sudden, if things start to happen and changes within you, changes within other people start happening, you know then a connection has been made and the Lord is talking with you and wanting you to grow. And just keep growing every day. Small little things, small little challenges, just keep pressing forward, keep pressing forward. And if you keep your heart open, he will come. God bless you, and hang in there. There's a lot of great life left. Let's all enjoy it.